You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
If you haven't watched the show before, I'm a plant pathologist and botanist and an arborist. And I also have a California Agricultural Pest Control Advisor's license. Apparently we need to cut to video because I forgot to put on my mic. So,
brought to you by LearnToGarden.net, your quality ornamental and landscape information source. Now, to help walk you through the do's and don'ts of perennial and rose gardening, here's your host, Master Gardener Waco Bankston.
Hi, welcome to another video blog of LearnToGarden.net. Today what we're going to do is look at pruning some hybrid tea roses that you see here behind me. And one of the methods that you want to use is to use loppers similar to this that we've also had in another video episode. But basically this gives you leverage to cut those bigger canes and branches. So what we want to do is begin by going through and basically leaving three or four major canes, one of the newer canes that are more green in color. And then we want to make sure we trim back to about a foot above the crown. And I'll show you what I'm talking about here in a second. Now what we're talking about when we talk about crown is this section here at the bottom. It's where the canes grow out of. Now sometimes you'll have the suckers that grow out from the rootstock, which is below the crown. But the crown here is what we're talking about. You want to prune about a foot above that crown, which is somewhere in this neighborhood. So we'll demonstrate that here now. Now one thing you can do when you're pruning the roses is it's a time where you can shape the bush. You see all these little pencil-sized stems here growing internal to the bush. You want to trim those out. You can just do that right at the cane. But another thing you want to do in terms of shaping is you can see these bud eyes here. If you can get close there, you can see these bud eyes on the cane here. Well, wherever you see a bud eye, it's going to grow in that direction. So for instance, if I prune right here, this one, this bud eye here is going to produce a cane growing this way, which is internal to the bush. You want them kind of growing out, so it's a way you can shape the bush. So if I go up about a foot from the crown, right in here, so right about a foot above the crown is where I'm going to trim. And if I prune right here, right above this bud eye, about a fourth inch with a slanted cut, about a 45 degree angle, what that's going to do is produce a cane growing out this way, and it'll shape the bush well. So I'm going to just make the pruning cut about a fourth an inch here without getting hit, and then just remove the cane. And now if you see the finished cut, you've got a cut with a slight angle on it so that any water doesn't settle there on top of the cane. And then you've got your bud eye about a fourth inch below the cut, and it's going to produce a cane growing out in that direction. So now,
well, welcome back. I'm sorry I forgot to put on my microphone, but this is Gardens of California, and my name is Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. And today we're going to talk about roses, and that's why we have a series of rose videos to share with you. We have videos on how to prune, videos on old roses. We have a variety of videos to share with you. Maybe we'll come back to that pruning video later. But we always like to start our show with upcoming events, and then we'll talk about some plants I brought in. And then, of course, this is a live broadcast, and you can call in with your questions about your garden at 1-800-339-1193. Anything about your garden you want to talk about. Maybe you don't have a problem and you just want to tell us how beautiful your garden is doing. But if you have a specific problem, if you had plants not do well, die, or they're just not thriving, they're exhibiting various symptoms that something's wrong with them, stunting, poor color, no fruit, whatever the problem is, give us a call. You can email us questions about your garden as well at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. It's there at the bottom of the screen. And attach a photograph of whatever you want to talk about, and we'll bring that picture up as well. So anything you want to talk about, give us a call. We have three events to share with you today. You put on your calendar. If you are a student in the class, you need to attend an outside event and then write a short essay about what you learned at the event. And the whole point of that is to go out and learn something new about plants or gardening. And then show me that you learned something. So you can go to a garden club, you can go to a class at one of the botanical gardens, a lecture on some type of something about plants or gardens. Let's take a look at our first upcoming event. And we have Learn About Horticulture with Frank McDonough on March 4th from 1:30 to 3 o'clock. Frank is the plant information specialist at the Los Angeles County Arboretum, and he always covers some of the latest issues affecting plants and trees in Southern California at these events, at his little lecture that he gives. And usually it's for, most of the people who attend are volunteers there at the Arboretum, but it's a great opportunity to learn more about the Arboretum and plant materials. In addition to that, we have Ikebana Basic and Advanced at the Los Angeles Arboretum, Los Angeles County Arboretum, March 20th from 9:30 to 11, in the Bamboo Room that's downstairs under the library. And you can give them a call at 626-821-4623 if you have any other questions. And of course, Ikebana, if you're not familiar with that, is the Japanese art of flower arranging. It's considered kind of the epitome of flower arranging. And there's certain elements that make it Ikebana, and really beautiful, beautiful way to arrange flowers. In addition to that, we have the Cherry Blossom Festival coming up at Descanso Gardens on March 21st and 23rd. If you have a question, give them a call at 818-949-4200. Of course, it's spring, just around the corner. We did get a little rain, but the cherry trees that people grow in Southern California are starting to bloom, and you can expect them to be blooming well on the weekend of March 21st and 22nd. Descanso has a nice collection of flowering cherries and some other flowering fruit trees as well. So that's our upcoming events. The other thing is that I have some plants, and I brought this genus, or I should say family, in before. I'm going to use this as a mystery plant. We like to have a mystery plant for you to call in and guess what it is. This is a real simple one, but in a way, I just want to share some of the things that are blooming in my garden as well. So here it is, and here is the bloom that's just starting. And if you know, this is an easy one. If you want to guess the family, it's pretty easy. If you recognize the genus, you can call me and tell me, because to tell you the truth, I don't know. This was originally given to me as a cutting. I potted it, grew it up. Now it's flowering, and it's produced a lot more plants coming off the base that you call them pups. And so here's one that's in the family. And it's, of course, got this new flower that's just starting. And none of the flowers have actually opened yet. So I'm really excited about this one blooming for me. And if I tip it over a little, you can see that inflorescence just a little bit better right there. Well, that's going to be really pretty when it blooms. And a couple of other plants are actually throwing flowers, too. So that's going to be fun. Let me shove that over and show you another in the family. And there's a lot of plants in this family. I'll tell you another one. You know, this one has some old blooms on here that are now faded. And here's one that's still, well, that one's a little faded too right there. These are pretty easy to grow. They might be a little tender. This bloom is this inflorescence is a little younger. But if you recognize this plant family, give me a call. Take a guess. And if you actually are one of the hobbyists who like to grow these, then you can take a guess at the genera. And actually, I'd love to know. In fact, I'm probably going to take these down one of these days and I'm going to have to set this one down because it's so big. It blocks the camera. So there we go. And maybe I'll just pull this one a little closer just to keep it in the frame. Now today we're going to talk about roses, and I'm talking about the history of roses and the different kinds of roses, and it's a big subject because roses are huge, huge, huge. They are by far the most popular ornamental plant in the world. You can grow them almost anywhere. Of course, you have to select just the right varieties if you're in a very harsh environment or, you know, an environment that's not really conducive for most roses. So if you're in, you know, Canada, you've got to choose cold hardy roses, or you have to protect them during the winter. If you're out in the desert, you need to carefully select the roses you're gonna grow. If you're in a hot inland valley, you can grow pretty much any rose you want. Along the coast, you might want to be a little more careful about disease resistance, and we'll talk a lot about that in a moment. This is an old book I got years and years ago, Ortho Books, all about roses. There are many, many books on roses. There's probably thousands, almost as many books on roses as there are roses. But you know, this is a nice little book on roses. It talks about old roses and new roses and rose care and diseases and pests. And this is an ortho book, probably not, and it may be out of print, it's so old. And of course, this is one of the modern roses here on the cover. Kind of looks like peace, but I'm not sure if that's it. And then in the Sunset Western Garden book, right here, which is our text for this class, there's a large section on roses, and that's why I often say that this book, the Sunset Western Garden book, is the first book you should purchase for your garden library, and maybe the only book you'll really need. It's an encyclopedia of plants. You can look up any kind of plant material you want to read about, and it has excellent information. And just to kind of touch on what's in here on roses, and how many pages on roses do they have? 1, 2, 3, 4. They have front and back 4 or 5 pages on roses, and they really cover them pretty much in depth with a lot of information on specific varieties. So what they start out their discussion of roses. Roses is undoubtedly the best loved flower and most widely planted shrub in the West and all other temperate parts of the world. Although mostly deciduous, roses can be evergreen in mild climates. Centuries of hybridizing have brought us the widest possible range of forms and colors. Nothing could be more true. One time I kind of did a little research on apples. There are 10,000 varieties of apples grown around the world. 10,000 varieties of apple, Malus domestica. That's phenomenal. There's even more varieties of roses. There's probably, I didn't go on the American Rose Society website. I should have, I really tell you the truth. There are tens of thousands of named roses and rose species and old roses and modern roses and all that. There's everything out there. So you couldn't possibly grow them all. No one could. So you do need to pick the one that you like and the one that will do well in your garden. There is a new emphasis on disease resistance in roses. In the past, not long ago, rose breeders were almost exclusively interested in the flower and fragrance. And they really didn't care about the diseases very much because everyone would just say, well, you just spray, you just treat the disease, but that's not the mindset today. Today, people really don't want to have a problem plant that you got to spray all the time. Getting powdery mildew, getting rust, or getting black spot. Those are your three most common problems on roses in terms of diseases. So, there's a renewed emphasis on disease resistance. And in some areas, it's really important that you pick roses with good resistance to powdery mildew and rust and to black spot. So take a close look at that, especially if you live along the coast where you get a lot of fog. Those are conditions that are more conducive to those diseases than hot inland valleys or desert areas, which are much drier. So let's start talking about roses. You know, before I talk about roses, we had a phone call last week because we were talking a little bit about genetically modified organisms, GMOs. Mostly we're talking about plants that have been genetically modified to carry genes from other organisms that benefit the plant or benefit the production of the plant. Specifically, corn and potato and cotton have been transformed to have traits that prevent insect pests or allow the application of herbicides over them. And of course, my opinion is that these GMOs are absolutely harmless. The US EPA's opinion is that they're absolutely harmless. They've actually been around for decades now, and no one has ever gotten sick eating one. So the accumulated evidence is that they're harmless. And just to go into a little detail, corn and cotton were transformed to carry a gene from a bacteria called Bacillus thuringiensis, or BT. And we've talked about BT in the past. BT is a naturally occurring bacteria on plant surfaces. And when caterpillars eat it, it kills them. It there's toxins that the bacteria makes. Excuse me. There are toxins the bacteria makes that disrupt the gut of the insect, cause a hole in it, and the caterpillar stops eating and then starves to death within a day or two. Bacillus thuringiensis, you can go buy it in little, you know, it usually is sold as under a variety of names like caterpillar killer at Osh. I've seen it there. You get it at Home Depot and Lowe's and Osh and Armstrong and any garden center. And it'll often say something like a caterpillar killer or Dipel, or there's a variety of names. Look down and it'll say the active ingredient is Bacillus thuringiensis. Well, you can take the gene that codes for the toxin, you can put it into a plant, the plant will make the toxin. Then when a caterpillar starts feeding on the plant, it kills the plant. So that's been done to corn, it's been done because both of those have major moth pests, like the corn earworm is a moth, and the caterpillar is down in the ear feeding on the corn, and it does a lot of damage. So you either have to spray your crop to protect it, or you can go get transgenic or GMO cotton or corn and put it out, and the caterpillars don't eat on it. Well, we had a call last week saying that there was a paper published saying that monarch butterflies were being damaged by the pollen from transgenic or GMO corn. So that confused me a little bit. I think I recall something about that in the past, but what confused me was that monarch butterflies don't feed on corn and don't visit corn. Monarch butterflies, the adults, feed on nectar from certain plants, and the caterpillars feed exclusively on milkweed. So I wondered, how would the caterpillars consume the pollen and then get enough of the BT toxin to kill them? Because it didn't make a whole lot of sense to me. So I was reading more about it actually this morning, and the paper that was published out of India, what they actually did was they took pollen from corn plants that carried the BT gene and sprinkled that pollen on milkweed and then had the caterpillars feed on the milkweed. And indeed, if you feed pollen to caterpillars from genetically modified corn, it does affect them. It doesn't kill them all. Their conclusions were that the caterpillars experienced a higher mortality rate, that they were smaller, and they didn't get as big than caterpillars just feeding on clean milkweed, or caterpillars feeding on milkweed with pollen from corn that's not genetically modified. So that was an interesting paper to some extent, but I still wondered how much pollen gets on milkweed where they grow corn in the Midwest. The answer is very little to none, because pollen from corn mostly falls in the immediate vicinity of the corn. Even though people will say it can be blown long distances, very, very little of it can be blown long distances. The vast majority of it will fall within a few feet of the corn plant. The pollen at the top of the plant is going to release and fall down on the silk coming out of the corn ear, and then it's going to land on the corn. It's not going to go very far. So the US EPA actually looked into that and found that not enough of the pollen would ever get on milkweed to affect caterpillars. Now, the reality is that monarch butterflies, of course, are having some serious problems in populations. Their populations are going down, and there's a lot of very real reasons for that. Predominantly, the lack of milkweed, because that's all the caterpillar can feed on. And so it's habitat destruction. Whereas you had milkweed all over the place before, now you have farms, and they get rid of the milkweed because it's a weed. So that and the lack of places to roost during the winter, because, you know, monarchs migrate. It's a multi-generational migration, and which means, you know, they're overwintering in Mexico or in California in the spring, so they're adults. In the spring, when it warms up, they start flying north, and as they find milkweed, they lay eggs. And then the eggs hatch, the caterpillar comes out, feeds on the milkweed, eventually becomes an adult butterfly, and continues the northward journey. Eventually, they start coming south again, and they come back to roost. It's a phenomenal event, and just shows you how spectacular biology can be. The idea that GMO corn is affecting monarchs is, what's the term I want? Hogwash. It's ludicrous. It's silly. The paper didn't prove anything. All they proved is if you feed pollen from GMO corn to caterpillars, it affects them. But caterpillars in the wild don't eat any, so who cares? So I just wanted to mention that. People who think that GMO plants are destroying the earth are delusional, and there's no basis to it in science. And since I'm basically a scientist, I don't subscribe to those theories. I also had my children immunized, which is, you know, a lot more hogwash that you hear on the internet and from people who are foolish. Well, let's talk about roses, because they're great. I have a little problem coughing here a little bit, but I'm okay. So roses were grown in all the early civilizations of temperate latitudes from at least 5,000 years ago. They're known to have been grown in Babylon. Paintings of roses have been discovered in Egyptian pyramid tombs from the 14th century BC. Records exist of them being grown in Chinese gardens and Greek gardens from at least 500 BC. So this is another, what we would call a biblical plant, or a plant that predates modern civilization. And there's a handful of plants that fall into that category. Most of the plants grown in these early gardens were probably species that were collected from the wild. However, there were large numbers of selected varieties being grown from early times. Numerous selections or cultivars of the China rose were in cultivation in China in the first millennium AD. Significant breeding of modern times started slowly in Europe from about the 17th century, and this was encouraged by the introduction of new species, and especially by the introduction of the China rose into Europe in the 19th century. An enormous range of roses has been bred since then. In fact, it's just phenomenal. A major contributor in the early 19th century was Empress Josephine of France, who patronized the development of rose breeding in her gardens. As long ago as 1840, a collection numbering over 1,000 different cultivars, varieties, and species was possible when a rosarium was planted in Abbey Park, a cemetery. So in 1840, there were thousands of roses that you could grow. Garden Cemetery and Arboretum in England. That's what Abbey Park Cemetery is. Roses are placed in one of three main groups. There are wild roses, old garden roses, and modern roses. The latter two groups are usually subdivided further according to hybrid lineage, although due to the complex ancestry of most rose hybrids, such distinctions can be imprecise. Growth habit and floral form are also used as means of classification. So, wild roses. The wild rose, also known as a species rose, include the natural species and some of their immediate hybrid descendants. The wild roses commonly grown in gardens include Rosa moschata. Let's bring up Rosa moschata and take a look at this. If we can get our first picture up and bring that up full screen. If we can get that full screen. This is Rosa moschata, and this is a species rose. Now, in addition to that, there's also the musk rose. Rosa moschata is the musk rose. Rosa banksia, or Lady Banks rose, is our next one. Bring that up. This is also a species rose, Lady Banks. If we could bring up our second picture. Here you go. So this is a species rose. So if you're interested in species roses, these are something you might want to grow. Species is Rosa pimpinillifolia, the Scots or Burnett rose. And if we can bring that up, number three. So this is a single rose, white, obviously. There is also Rosa rubiginosa is another species rose. It's called the sweetbriar or elegantine rose. And let's bring up number four. So what we're looking at here are all species roses. There's also Rosa foetida, which is our fifth picture. And there are several varieties. There's Austin Cooper, Persian Double, and Harrison's Yellow. And this one here we see is Harrison's Yellow. For most of these plants, the plants found in cultivation are often selected clones that are propagated vegetatively. Wild roses are low-maintenance shrubs in comparison to other garden roses, usually tolerating poor soil and some shade. They generally only have one flush of blooms per year, although some species have large hips in autumn. Autumn foliage. Let's see here. The Rosa moschata, which we looked at first, is a species of rose long in cultivation. Its wild origins are uncertain, but suspected to lie in the western Himalayas. Now, Rosa banksia, the common Lady Banks rose, is a species, and it is from central and western China in the province of Gansu, Henan, Hubei, Jiangsu, Yunnan, usually found at altitudes of 500 to 2200 meters, so fairly high. And the Rosa pimpinifolia is a species native to western, central, and southern Europe. Africa. It is generally restricted to sand dunes or limestone pavements and typically has a coastal distribution. Rosa foetida, known by several common names, is a species of rose native to the foothills of the Caucasus Mountains in Georgia. So Harrison's Yellow, also known as the Oregon Trail Rose and Yellow Rose of Texas, is a hybrid rose cultivar which originated, and that's what we're looking at behind me, is the Harrison's Yellow. First bloomed at the suburban villa of George Harrison, attorney at between 8th and 9th Avenues on 32nd Street in New York City. I wonder if that's true, because some of these notes I get are from Wikipedia, and sometimes things are not quite true. The site of Harrison's villa is now just south of the present General Post Office. So Harrison's Yellow is naturalized at abandoned house sites through the West and is found as a feral rose along the Oregon Trail. Rosa moissii is a species native to western China. Let's take a look at number six and bring this up. This is Rosa moissii. So another native to China. A vigorous deciduous shrub with plentiful matte green leaves and flat red or pink flowers, yellow central stamens in summer. These are followed in autumn by prominent bottle-shaped rose hips. So those are the species, those are just some of the species roses you might be interested in. In addition to that, we've got the old garden roses. And these are defined as any rose belonging to a class which existed before the introduction of the first modern rose of France in 1867. 1867 is the dividing line between old garden roses and modern garden roses. There are alternative terms for this group, including heritage or historic roses. In general, They are of European or Mediterranean origin, are once blooming woody shrubs with notable fragrant double-flowered blooms, primarily in shades of white, pink, and crimson red. The shrub's foliage tends to be highly disease-resistant, and they generally bloom only from canes, which formed in the previous years. Most old garden roses are classified into one of the following groups that we'll talk about briefly. And so let's talk about them. Alba, and this is what we see here is Maiden's Blush. This is an alba rose. Of course, that literally means white rose. They are derived from Rosa arvinus and a closely related RX alba, which is a hybrid. The latter species is a hybrid of Gallica and Canina. This group contains some of the oldest garden roses. The shrubs flower once yearly in the spring or early summer with scented blooms of white or pale pink. They frequently have gray-green foliage and vigorous or climbing habit of growth. So there's, in addition to this maiden rose or maiden blush that we see here, there's also Alba Simplina and the white rose of York. Now the next group of old garden roses are the Gallica roses or Rose of Provence group. This is a very old class developed from Rosa Gallica, which is a native of Central and Southern Europe and Western Asia. It's also known as the Apothecary's Rose, Rosa Gallica officinalis. It was grown in the Middle Ages in monastic herbaria for its alleged medicinal properties and became famous in English history as the Red Rose of Lancaster. Gallica's flower, and then what we have here in front of us is the wild rose Gallica this Romanica. Gallica's flower once in the summer over low shrubs, rarely over 4 feet. Unlike most other once-blooming old garden roses, the Gallica class includes shades of red, maroon, and deep purplish crimson. Other examples would be Cardinal de Richelieu, Charles de Mills, Rosa Mundi. Cultivars of the species Rosa Gallica and hybrids close in appearance are considered as a cultivar group, the Gallica group roses. Their exact ancestry is usually unknown, and other species may be involved. So we continue on about the Rosa Gallica. Let's take a look at number 9. This is Rosa Gallica officinalis. Really, really, really nice. And then this next one is Rosa Gallica Charles de Mille, which is shows you this typical old rose form with flat petals around the edge and then these kind of curved or twisted petals in the middle. Really pretty form that you're not going to see very much in modern roses at all. So Gallica, of course, as I said, is native to Southern and Central Europe, eastwards to Turkey and the Caucasus. They have semi-double pink flowers and have been treated as either a variety under the name Rosa Gallica variety officinalis or as a cultivar Gallica officinalis. This is also called the Apothecary's Rose, the Crimson Damask Rose, or the Red Rose of Lancaster. It is the county flower of Lancaster, Lancashire. A cultivar R. Gallica variety officinalis versicolor with striped pink blooms is also known as Rosa Mundi, which I think we just saw that picture a moment ago. Now let's take a look at number 11, which is another Rosa Gallica. This is Tuscany Superb. And again, you can see this, you know, old rose kind of form to the flower. This species is easily cultivated on well-drained soil in full sun to semi-shade. It can survive temperatures as low as minus 25 degrees centigrade, phenomenally cold. It is one of the earliest cultivated species of roses, cultivated by the Greek and Romans, and commonly used in medieval gardens. In the 19th century, it was the most important species of rose to be cultivated, and most modern European rose cultivars have at least a small contribution from Gallica in their ancestry. Now, the next group of roses we want to talk about are the Damask roses. Named for Damascus, Damask roses, Rosa ex Damascena, originated in ancient times with a natural cross of Moschata, by him crossed with Gallica. and then crossed again with another rose species, Robert De Beer is given credit for bringing damask roses from the Middle East to Europe sometime between 1254 and 1276. Although there is evidence from ancient Rome frescoes that at least one damask rose existed in Europe for hundreds of years before this. Summer damasks bloom once in summer. Autumn or four seasons damasks bloom again later, but less exuberantly. And these were the first repeat flowering old European roses. Damask roses tend to have rangy, sprawling growth habits and strongly scented blooms. And what we're looking here is Rosa damascena. If we look at our next picture, that's autumn damask. If we take a look at this next picture. And again, this when I see this form, these kind of twisted petals like that, you know, they do this all the way around. That just speaks of old roses to me, old garden roses. And it's really, quite different from the modern roses. There's also Ispahan and Madame Hardy. And let's see if I have, our next picture is Ispahan, Rosa Ispahan, 14, there you go. So let's move on and talk a little bit more about the damask roses. Rosa, and of course it's referred to as Rosa X damascena, or damask rose, also known as the Rose of Castile, derived from Gallica and Moscata. It also has a third species that in its heritage, Rosa fetichincoana, hard to pronounce. The flowers are renowned for their fine fragrance and commercially harvested for rose oil, used in perfumery and to make rose water and rose concrete. The flower petals are also edible. They may used to flavor food as a garnish or as an herbal tea and preserved in sugar. The damask rose is a deciduous shrub growing to about 7 feet in height. The stems densely armed with stout curved prickles and stiff bristles. The leaves are pinnate with rarely seven leaflets. The roses are light to moderate pink to light red. The relatively small flowers grow in groups. The bush has an informal shape. It is considered an important type of old rose and also important for the prominent place in the pedigree of many other roses. Ispahan, which we saw just a moment ago, or actually we're looking at right now, I should say, is also known as the Pompon de Princes, is a clear pink, half-opened kind of damask, introduced from the Middle East in Europe breeding during the crusading 13th century. David Austin recommends it highly as a free flowering among the first old roses to start blooming and the last to continue, and its fine damask fragrance. The name Ispahan is derived from the city of Isfahan in Iran. So, now let's talk about the centifolia roses. The centifolia roses are also known as cabbage roses or province roses. Our next picture, number 15, is Rosa centifolia. They are derived from Rosa centifolia raised in the 17th century in the Netherlands or Holland. They are named for their 100 petals. And if you look at that and count all those petals, you'll find that there's exactly 100. I'm just joking. Where am I in my notes? They are often called cabbage roses due to the globular shape of the flowers. The result of damask roses crossed with albas, the centifolias are all once flowering. As a class, they are notable for their inclination to produce mutations of various sizes and forms, including moss roses and some of the first miniature roses. Example, centifolia, which we're looking at there. Let's take a look at there you go. There's another Rosa centifolia. And there's also Paul Richard, which I don't have a photo of. The province rose or cabbage rose, developed by Dutch rose breeders in the 17th and 19th centuries, possibly earlier. It is a complex hybrid. Breed from Gallica, Moschata, Cania, and Damascena. So individual plants are shrubby in appearance, growing to 1.5 to 2 meters tall, that'd be up to about 6 feet, with long drooping canes and grayish green pinnate leaves. The flowers are round and globular with numerous thin overlapping petals that are highly scented. They are usually pink, less often white to dark red purple. Centifolia is particular to the French city of Grasse, known as the perfume capital of the world. It is widely cultivated for its singular fragrance. Clear and sweet, with light notes of honey, the flowers are commercially harvested for the production of rose oil, which is commonly used in perfumery. Now, our next group of roses are the moss roses. Let's bring up number 17. And this is the common moss rose. The moss roses are based on a mutation of Rosa centifolia, the Provence or cabbage rose, some with damask roses as another parent. They bear mossy resin-bearing glands on the sepals that often gives off a pleasant woodsy or balsam scent when rubbed. Moss roses are cherished for this unique trait. But as a group, they have not contributed further to development of new rose classifications. Moss roses with centifolia background are once flowering. Some moss roses exhibit repeat blooming, indicated of autumn damask parentage. There's common moss. Let's see what else. There's common moss. There's also mousseline, also known as Alfred de Damas, autumn damask rose. Now let's talk about the Portland rose. We'll move on from moss roses. And this picture here is the Portland rose. The Portland roses were long thought to be the first group of crosses between China roses and European roses, and to show the influence of Rosa chinensis. Recent DNA analysis, however, has demonstrated that the original Portland rose has no Chinese ancestry, but has an autumn damask gallica lineage. This group of roses was named after the Duchess of Portland, who received from Italy in 1775 a rose then known as the Scarlet Four Seasons Rose, now simply known as the Portland Rose. The whole class of Portland roses was developed from that one rose. The first repeat flowering class of rose with fancy European-style blooms. The plants tend to be fairly short and shrubby, with a suckering habit, with proportionately shorter flower stalks. The main flowering is in the summer, but intermittent flowers continue in the autumn. Examples, James Vitek. Let's take a look at, this is the Portland rose, but there are other Portland roses. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is, bring that up full screen. This is James Vitek. And there's also pictures I don't have, Rosa de Visite and Comte de Chambord. Now, let's talk about the China roses, because the introduction of China roses into Europe was the beginning of the modern roses. The China roses, based on Rosa chinensis, have been cultivated in East Asia for centuries. They have been cultivated in Western Europe since the late 18th century. They contribute much to the parentage of today's hybrid roses, and they brought a change to the form of the flowers then cultivated in Europe. Compared with the older rose classes known in Europe, the Chinese roses had less fragrant, smaller blooms carried over twiggy, more cold-sensitive shrubs. However, they could bloom repeatedly throughout the summer and into late autumn, unlike their European counterparts. The flowers of China roses were also notable for their tendency to suntan or darken over time, unlike other blooms, which tend to fade after opening. This made them highly desirable for hybridization purposes in the early 19th century. China roses are the class upon which modern roses are built. Today's exhibition rose owes its form to the China genes, and the China rose also brought slender buds which unfurl when opening. So let's take a look at Rosa mutabilis is our next rose. And so when the flowers open, they're this color, and then as they age, they get darker. So that was a really quite different phenomena from the European roses, which tended to fade as they got older. So let's see, traditions hold that four stud China roses, Slater's Crimson, Parsons Pink, and the Tea Roses, Hume's Blessed Tea-Scented China, and Park's Yellow Tea-Scented China were brought to Europe in the late 18th and 19th centuries. In fact, they were rather more, or at least five China roses, not counting the teas, have been imported. And this, of course, is a mutabilis butterfly rose bush. We just saw the flowers a moment ago. So the importation of all these China roses brought about the creation of the first classes of repeat flowering old garden roses and later the modern garden roses. The first repeat old blush China, there's old blush China and then mutabilis, the butterfly rose, and that's what we're looking at here. This is called the butterfly rose. And this was one of the first hybrids that was developed using China roses and European old garden roses. Let's talk about a little bit of mutabilis. Prior to 1894, this most interesting rose was once sold as tipo ideal and is ideally suited to illustrate the typical China trait of darkening with age. Nowhere is that trait more visible than in flowers of mutabilis. So this is Rosa mutabilis, mutabilis. I may be pronouncing that a little off. Whose single petals often open sulfur yellow, changing through orange to rich pink and finally crimson. Bright, silky flowers of all these colors will often be on display at the same time, looking as if a group of multicolored butterflies has settled on the bush. This aspect earned mutabilis its common name, the butterfly rose. And a healthy, well-branched shrub, mutabilis will easily grow to 6 feet, making a fine specimen plant whose showy flowers are accented by the bronze color of the new growth. This is a very popular rose due to its distinct coloration. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our first caller of the day. So, Gordon, calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Oh, thank you. I wonder if you know the name of the tree that's flowering now in the Pasadena area. It's a yellow flowering tree. It's all over the tree.
It's yellow? Yellow flowers?
Yeah.
This time of year?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the only one that comes to my mind right off the bat would be the golden trumpet tree. Is this a big tree or a small tree?
Well, the tree itself is kind of small. I don't know, is it something like an acacia or something?
It could be an acacia, but it seems a little early for acacias to be blooming. Acacias have little round ball-like flowers. Does it have a tubular flower or what's...
No, it's not a tubular, it's round.
Oh, it could easily be an acacia.
Okay. Now, can you grow those from the seed pods? You know, the seed pods are long.
Yes, you could easily grow them from seed if you wanted to. You better be
how
patient.
What now?
You better be very patient.
Oh, I was going to say, how long does it take before it would actually flower?
Well, it may take quite a long time. You're going to have to grow the seed up into a tree. It may not bloom for quite a few years. It's hard for me to say.
What, 10 years maybe?
Yeah, I would think 5 to 10 years would be a reasonable estimate. Some plants will bloom early as seedlings. Others will take many, many years to bloom from a seedling. And often when people are crossing trees or creating hybrids and they want to see what the flower is right away, they actually graft it onto a large rootstock and they'll get the flower many years early.
Oh.
If you've got a picture, a digital image, and if you want to email it to us, I would have a better idea what you're talking about. But generally speaking, if the plant is making seed, yes, you can grow it from seed. I'd be surprised it wouldn't grow from seed. I don't know why it wouldn't. But like I said, often you're going to wait many years for it to become a mature plant. I grow from seed all the time. I love to do it. But like I said, you need to have a lot of patience waiting for that first bloom.
Well, it doesn't sound like it's feasible at this point because 5 to 10 years is an awfully long time.
That's true. Now, can you get a picture and email it to us?
I'll try next week.
Okay. If you give me a picture, then I can give you a better idea what it is. And then, of course, you can always take a cutting into, a quality nursery will be able to tell you what it is.
Are these plants or trees, are they easily available in most nurseries?
If it's a, did we take cassia? Not cassia. What were we talking about? Acacia.
Acacia.
The acacias are widely available, are commonly available in many nurseries. Although there's a lot of species of acacias, and if you're looking for a very specific species, you might have to look around a little bit. But right. there are some that are very popular, so the common species of acacia are widely available.
Well, it's just a very pretty color of yellow, and it just looks like a yellow cloud.
But they're little balls, little yellow balls.
Probably.
Yeah. The other thing that might be blooming would be the golden trumpet tree, which has tubular flowers.
No.
The thing about acacias is that they are in the pea family, and they typically have very tiny leaflets.
Okay.
So if you took a... You know, they're usually pinnate or bipinnate, which means the leaf is divided into one set of leaflets or it's twice divided into leaflets. And it won't have a big, huge leaf, you know,
well,
like an
it's
avocado.
It's bare now.
Hmm? Oh, it's bare right now. It's deciduous.
Yeah.
Hmm. I'd have to look into it a little bit, but if you can get a picture and email it to us, I ought to be able to identify it.
All right. Well, I'll do that, and hopefully you can help me.
Okay, thank you
all
for calling.
Thank you.
So, yeah, if you have any pictures you want to email us, just email them to askdhtvlive@gmail.com. We've had pictures of trees and stuff sent in repeatedly over the years. I guess we have another caller. Let's go to our next caller. No callers? Okay, let's talk about the tea roses, also from China. The original tea-scented Chinas, Rosa X odorata, were oriental cultivars thought to represent hybrids of Rosa chinensis with Rosa gigantea, a large Asian climbing rose with pale yellow blooms. Immediately upon their introduction in the early 19th century, breeders went to work with them, especially in France, crossing them first with China roses and then with Bourbons and Noisettes. The tea roses are repeat flowering roses named for their fragrance being reminiscent of Chinese black tea, although this is not always the case. The color range includes pastel shades of white, pink, and a novelty at the time, yellow to apricot. So let's take a look at some of let's take a look at number 22, which is Parsons Pink or Old Blush. Bring that up full screen. The individual flowers of many cultivars are semi-pendant and nodding due to weak flower stalks. In a typical tea, pointed buds produce high-centered blooms which unfurl in a spiral fashion, and the petals tend to roll back at the edges. Now you can see this is kind of a little pendant right here, just a little bit. And this is Parkinson's Pink. But let me go on about the details on the teas. The teas are the originators of today's classic florist rose forms. According to rose historian Brent Dickerson, the tea classification owes as much to marketing as to botany. 19th century nurserymen would label their Asian-based cultivars as teas if they possessed the desirable tea flower form, and Chinas if they did not. Like the Chinas, the teas are hardy in colder climates. There's Lady Hillington, Madame Crochet, Duchess de Barbus, and Mrs. Fulby Hobbs. I wonder if I've skipped some roses here. Nope. So those are the teas, and I think I kind of jumped the gun. I may not have a picture of teas. Let's talk about the Bourbon roses. They originated off the coast of Madagascar in the Indian Ocean. They are believed to be the result of a cross between Autumn Damask and the Old Blush China Rose, and this is the Old Blush China Rose right here, both of which were frequently used as hedging materials on the island. They flower repeatedly on vigorous, frequently semi-climbing shrubs with glossy foliage and purple-tinted canes. They were first introduced in France in 1823. And there are examples of Bourbon roses are Louise Audier, Madame Pierre Auger, and the last example is often classified under climbing roses, which is Zeffirini Druin. So there are climbing roses and bush roses. I mean, that's another way to classify them. Now the Noisette, I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly.
The first Nocetti rose was raised as a hybrid seedling by a South Carolina rice planter named John Champagnat. Its parents were China rose Parsons Pink and autumn flowering musk rose Rosa Moschata, resulting in vigorous climbing rows producing huge clusters of small pink flowers from spring to fall. And now this is called Champy's Pink Cluster. Champy sent seedlings of his rose to his gardening friend, Philip Noisette, who sent plants to his brother in Paris, who then introduces Blush's Noisette in 1817. The first Noisettes were small blossom, fairly winter-hardy climbers, but later infusions of tea rose genes created a tea Noisette subclass with larger flowers, smaller clusters, and considerably reduced winter hardiness. And the examples of that are Blush Noisette, Lamarque, Alfred Curry, and let's see what we have here. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is Cremus Superior, which is probably going to be one of our next roses. Then there are the hybrid musk roses. Although they arose too late to qualify technically as old garden roses, the hybrid musks are often informally classified with them, since their growth habits and care are much more like old garden roses than modern roses. The hybrid musk group was mainly developed by a British rosarian, Joseph Pemberton, in the first decades of the 20th century, based upon Algalia, an 1896 cross by Peter Lambert. A seedling of this rose, Trier, is considered to be the foundation of the class. The genetics of the class are somewhat obscure, as some of the parents are unknown. Rosa multiflora, however, is known to be one parent, and Rosa moschata, the musk rose, also figures in its heritage, although it is considered to be less important than the name would suggest. So hybrid musks are disease resistant, repeat flowering, and generally clustered flowered with a strong characteristic musk scent. The stems tend to be lax and arching with limited thorns. This includes Buff Beauty and Penelope. The hybrid rugosas. The rugosas, likewise, are not officially old garden roses, but tend to be grouped with them. Derived from Rosa rugosa from Japan and Korea beginning in the 1880s, these vigorous roses are extremely hardy with excellent disease resistance. Most are extremely fragrant, repeat bloomers with moderately double flat flowers. The defining characteristics of hybrid rugosa, but some hybrids lack that trait. The roses will often set hips. There's Hansa and Rosaria Delay. And I'm trying to figure out, this one here we're looking at is called Camarosi Superior, and I'm not sure which group it falls into, but we'll know here in a moment. There are also smaller classes, and these are miscellaneous groups, Scots, Sweetbriar, some climbing classes of old roses, including Ashire, Climbing China, Sempervirens, Climbing Tea, Climbing Bourbon. These classes with both climbing and shrub roses forms are often grouped together. And then there are the modern garden roses. And before we move on to the modern, let's see here. Let's take a look at Lady, this one is called, the one we just looked at is Chromosis Superior. Our next one is Lady Hillington, and I'm going to need to check my notes here. But actually, let's go to our station identification. Usually right about the top of the hour, we like to take a short break and remind you that you're watching Dominguez Hills Television. So we're going to take this short station identification break, and when we come back, we'll talk more about roses, and we'll talk about the modern garden roses. And then we'll move on to some other issues about roses. You could talk about roses for months on end and still never repeat yourself. So we'll be back in about 5 to 10 minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi. I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills.
Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
You ought to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. Want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
My name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, my name is Lira Harding. I'm a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to Planetary Science and Astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world, and I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers, and this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love, love, love. Brother, love, that Mandarin sauce is ridiculous. The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Champion is the Literals.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California, the live broadcast where we talk about everything about gardens. We're talking about roses today, and I want to go back just a little bit to a few of our pictures and correct what these roses are, because I had them a little confused, and I'm not surprised there's so many roses. Let's go back to 22.
Actually, not 22, but let's go back to 23, which is Cramoisi Superior. This is a China rose. And if we do the next one, which is number 24, Lady Hillington. Lady Hillington is a tea rose, one of the tea roses from China. And you see that picture. And the next picture is also Lady Hillington, number 25. This is Lady Hillington. This is one of the tea-scented roses from China. And now if we go on to our next picture, which is 26, this is Louis Oder. Louis Oder is a bourbon rose, which originated in Madagascar and believed to be a result of a cross of Damask and Old Blush China rose, which we looked at earlier. And then in addition to that, we'll look at 27. This is a bourbon climbing rose. This is Souvenir de la Malmaison. And then if we look at our next picture, number 28, this is a Nocette rose. And let me see if I can pronounce this correctly. This is Desprez el Fleurs Jaune. It is a Nocette rose. And then there are the hybrid perpetuals, which we didn't talk about. Take a look at our next picture, 29. And this is a hybrid perpetual. And this is the dominant class of roses in Victorian England, hybrid perpetuals, a misleading translation of reblooming hybrids, emerged in 1838 as the first roses which successfully combined Asian repeat blooming with the old European lineages. Since rebloom is a recessive trait, the first generation were stubbornly once blooming, but when these roses were recrossed with themselves or with China roses or teas, some of their offspring flowered more than once. The hybrid perpetuals were something of a catch-all class derived to a great extent from the bourbons, but with admixtures of Chinas, teas, damask, gallicas, and to a lesser extent, nocettes, albas, and even centifolias. They became the most popular garden and florist roses of Northern Europe at the time, as the tender tea roses would not thrive in cold climates. And the hybrid perpetuals, very large blooms, were well suited to the new phenomena of competitive exhibitions. The perpetual in the name hints at repeat flowering, but many varieties of the class had poor reflowering habits. Here's another hybrid perpetual. It's called Ferdinand Richard, is number 30. And let's see, the perpetual hints at repeat flowering. The tendency was for a massive spring bloom, flowered by either scattered summer flowering, smaller autumn bursts, or sometimes nothing at all until next spring. They had a limited color palette, white, pink, and red, and lack of a reliable peat bloom. The hybrid perpetuals were overshadowed by their descendants, hybrid teas. And we talked about hybrid musk, I believe. The hybrid musks, let's take a look at number 31. This is a hybrid musk. And we mentioned that these were technically introduced too old to be old garden roses, but are often classified with them. And so the hybrid musks have a very strong musky odor or scent that you smell when you rub the foliage, actually. And then our next one is number 32, which is a hybrid rugosa, which this is Blanc Double de Calbert from 1893. This is a characteristic of the rugosas. Again, not officially old garden roses, but they tend to be grouped with them. This is derived from hybrid from Rosa rugosa from Japan and Korea in the 1880s. And then there's the Bermuda mystery roses. And let's see. We talked about those. This is a group of several dozen roses found growing in Bermuda for at least a century. The roses have significant value and interest for those growing roses in tropical and semi-tropical regions, since they are highly resistant to both nematode damage and fungal diseases. that plague rose culture in hot, humid areas. They are also capable of thriving in hot and humid weather. Most of these roses are thought to be old garden rose cultivars that have otherwise dropped out of cultivation. They are mystery roses because their proper historical names have been lost. So they're called Bermuda mystery roses. And then we talked about the miscellaneous roses. Now the modern garden roses, this classification of modern roses can be quite confusing because many modern roses have old garden roses in their ancestry and their form varies so much. The classifications tend to be by growth and flowering characteristics. The following includes the most notable and popular classifications. So the hybrid tea rose, as a favorite rose for much of the history of modern roses, hybrid teas were initially created by hybridizing hybrid perpetuals with tea roses in the late 19th century. LaFrance created in 1867, let's bring up our next picture, which is the LaFrance rose. That would be number 33. Hybrid trees, it was created in 1867 and is universally acknowledged as the first indication of a new class of roses. Hybrid teas exhibit traits midway between both parents, hardier than the teas, but less hardier than the hybrid perpetuals, and more ever-blooming than the hybrid perpetuals, but less so than the teas. The flowers are well-formed with large, high-centered buds, and each flowering stem typically terminates in a single bloom. The shrubs tend to be stiffly upright and sparsely foliated, which today is often seen as a liability because it makes them more difficult to place in the garden or landscape. Hybrid teas became the single most popular garden rose of the 20th century. Today, their reputation as high-maintenance plants has led to a decline in their popularity. The hybrid tea remains the standard rose of the floral industry, and it is still favored in formal situations. We're going to show a series of these, but we have another caller. So let's go to our next phone call, and then we'll move on and talk about hybrid teas. Terry, calling from Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yes, I have a question. I have a white ash tree.
Okay.
And it's pretty big. It has a 4-foot diameter trunk, and it's very large. And I wanted to know how often these trees fall over, because I'm worried it's going to fall over my house.
Okay, well, I doubt that you have a white ash. If you've got a very large ash tree, and you can distinguish ash trees because their leaves are pinnate, which means they have leaflets, and they terminate in a single leaflet. So there's a typical ash leaf that you can recognize ashes. And if you've got a very large ash with a 4-foot diameter trunk, which would be about 12 feet circumference, so you couldn't get your arms around it. And it's a very large tree. Most likely what you have is a chamel ash, and it's called Fraxinus udii. It's native to Mexico. And in my experience, they never fall over. But that doesn't mean they're a great tree. They are a very fast-growing tree. They will grow under almost any conditions. Of course, they grow faster if they're irrigated. But there's some characteristics about them that aren't so great. One is that they tend to develop what we call narrow crotches. So the trunk will come up, and it'll divide into two or three major scaffold branches or trunks even. But they have a very narrow crotch between the trunks. And narrow crotches are structural faults in trees. So what tends to happen on the chamel ash is it'll come up, it'll divide into several trunks, and then without warning, one of those trunks can rip and fall off the tree, leaving a large rip down the trunk. And they develop very large scaffold branches, and that growth habit is repeated throughout the canopy. So even when it's young, you keep pruning off those narrow crotches and keep one central leader, you often still don't develop a nice branching pattern, or what we'd call a safe branching pattern, because that's just the nature of the tree to develop narrow crotches. So that's one problem with that tree, is that it can drop major large branches and rip and fall away. The only way to deal with that is to prune them and to lighten the weight at the end of the branches. You often see them severely pruned because they can easily reach 75 feet with these enormous
scaffold branches. The other problem is that they are highly invasive. They are male and female trees. On the female trees, you'll get a winged fruit, and they will make millions of them. And they will all germinate and grow. And so there are some areas in Los Angeles, like Mount Washington, Mount Washington, that's what I'm thinking, above Highland Park, where some vacant lots are just solid shamal ash. In fact, every lot in the neighborhood is just covered with shamal ash. So it's extremely invasive. It's not likely for the whole tree to fall over. In fact, I've never seen a shamal ash fall over. They have massive trunks and massive roots. They break concrete left and right. You need probably 50 feet away from pavement in order to avoid cracking sidewalks and driveways and lifting streets. So they have a bad reputation, but they will grow up to 4 feet per year. And that's typical of large trees. Large trees get big because they grow fast. Small trees grow slowly and only grow a few inches a year, but fast-growing trees typically will get to 75 feet. So I doubt it will fall over, but it may rip a branch that may fall off the tree. So you probably need to have it thinned and have the height of the tree reduced, or even consider removing the tree, depending on how many trees you have in your property and whether you want, it's ideally suited to shade your house, like on the south or west side of the property where it'll shade your home, then you'd probably prefer just pruning it and thinning it.
Okay. Well, thank you for all that information. I appreciate it.
You should look up shamal ash on Google or a search engine and look at pictures, because I doubt that you have a white ash.
Oh, okay.
Okay?
Oh, all right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for calling, and thank you for watching the show. So we're talking about roses. Let's get back to our roses. We're talking about hybrid teas. Hybrid teas were absolutely one of the most popular varieties to grow, and they're still very popular, but they're usually grown for cut flowers, mostly, or at least that's a kind of a compelling reason people grow them, because they make really nice cut flowers with a large flower, you know, usually one flower at the end of a large, long cane. It is the main type of flower that you see sold in florist shops. So let's bring up this next picture, and what we see here is La France, and this is Peace, the Peace Rose. And let me just tell you a little bit more about the plants. It tends to be, the shrubs tend to be stiffly upright and sparsely foliated. Of course, this is Peace. Our next picture is also a Peace Rose. Let's take a look at that too. And the form you see here is typical of hybrid teas. And let me just go back and just mention a few things about what we're seeing here. La France is a rose developed in 1867. Generally accepted to be the first hybrid tea rose, and 1867 is the date at which roses become modern roses. Light pink flowers with up to 60 petals and a strong fragrance. The Peace Rose has a very interesting history. This was originally released under the name Madame A. Blonde is a well-known and successful garden rose. Over 100 million plants had been sold as of 1992. It is a hybrid tea rose with large flowers of a light yellow to cream color, slightly flushed at the petal edges with a crimson pink. It is hardy and vigorous and relatively resistant to disease, making it popular in gardens. It was developed by French horticulturalist Francis Meland in the years 1935 to 1939. When Meland foresaw the German invasion of France, he sent cuttings to his friends in Italy, Turkey, and Germany, and the United States to protect the new rose. It is said that it was sent to the U.S. on the last plane available before the German invasion, where it was safely propagated during the war. It was then given as a gift and became, after the war, and became known as the Peace Rose to celebrate the end of World War II. Our next is Double Delight. This is Double Delight, bred by Swim and Ellis and introduced in 1977.
Blooms repeatedly and has strongly fragrant white flowers with dark red edges, up to 30 petals. A really, really pretty flower. Our next one is Garden Party. Garden Party is a hybrid tea rose cultivar created by Herbert Swim in 1959. The double-shaped, let's go to our next picture, 37. The double-shaped flowers are creamy white with pink on the ends and have 25 to 28 petals. Blooms repeatedly. It is apparent to both gold medal and double delight. So this, what we saw, you see here, is called Garden Party. Our next, Peer Gynt is our next flower, number 38. Peer Gynt is a tall hybrid tea, yellow, 4.5-inch blooms with red edging. Repeat bloomer that will bring a ray of sunshine to your garden. Good for cutting and can be grown in a pot, petals 50. Our next one is Donna Darling from 1997. And by now you should be recognizing that hybrid tea look with a single bloom. This is a new rose variety of the hybrid tea class, distinctive coloring of iridescent red fading to pale yellow on a vigorous, disease-resistant bush with lush green foliage. Let's take a look at the next one, 40. This is also Donna Darling. And you can see the yellow more, a little better in this photograph, because Donna Darling, red fading to pale yellow. Now, Olympiad is our next hybrid tea. Pure red with all the qualities of great exhibition rose and prolific enough so that it can be depended upon for cutting all season long. The plants are tall, long-stemmed, and covered with fairly light green, heavily toothed foliage that is probably the most mildew-resistant in its class. Sam McGreedy had a strong belief that roses should be fragrant. Alas, this one has little fragrance, but it didn't stop it from being the best-selling red rose for most of the last 20 years. And the fragrance is slight, and the hybridizer is McGreedy, 1984. Now, before I move on, I do have a video I want to go to on old garden roses. I want you to, you know, we've already moved on to the hybrid teas, but let's go back and just take a look at some more of the old garden roses, because you want to really look at what the shrub looks like, because it's most of the year it's just going to be a shrub, because most of, you know, the old garden roses, the old English garden roses, the old European garden roses, typically only bloom in the spring. So let's take a look at our video clip, which is old garden roses gardening through the seasons, and then we'll talk a little bit more about moss roses. So let's take a look at this video clip.
Director of Gardens in the Department of Plant and Soil Sciences at Mississippi State University. We are at the Veterans Memorial Rose Garden, where I'd like to show you a variety of old garden roses. The first rose I want to show you today is a damask rose called Kazanlik. It's a large, wild-growing shrub, and it blooms only in the spring. This rose has a soft pink bloom, slightly double in form, and the foliage is rough and sage green. The second cultivar I'd like to show you comes from Germany in the 1930s. Its name is Dr. Eichener, and it is a hybrid rugosa rose. The blooms on Dr. Eichener are very large, and they're fragrant, and they repeat bloom throughout the season. One of the nice aspects of Dr. Eichener is that the blooms range from a deep peach pink to a pale soft pink as they age. This shrub also is large and coarsely growing, and the thorns are really vicious. It tolerates poor soils as well. The foliage that you see on Dr. Eichener is very typical of hybrid rugosas. The surface of the leaf is very rough and rugged and has a lot of veins prominent on the surface. An example of roses that are derived from warmer climates, such as are found throughout the southern part of Europe, the Middle East, or the Far East, is Pax. Pax is a hybrid musk rose that was developed in England in 1918, and that's an appropriate name for peace at the end of World War I. The shrub is large and has long arching stems and lacks growth habit that makes it nice to prop up against a fence. The blooms are a semi-double white and they bloom continuously throughout the year. Again, this plant will tolerate poor soils. This is an example of a China rose. Its name is Rosa chinensis mutabilis, or butterfly rose. It's large, it's very twiggy, and it has very healthy foliage, and it makes a good landscape shrub. The flowers are single, and they range in color from dark pink to pale yellow. Another example of a China rose is Cramoisie superior, which was developed in France in 1832. It's a smaller shrub and makes it more useful in smaller garden spaces. The flowers are dark red, they're semi-double, and they are produced in large clusters. Again, the bloom is continuous throughout the garden season. Another rose of very ancient garden origins is Rosa banksia lutea, or Lady Banks rose. It was imported in the early 1820s. The foliage is elegant, it's small, it has very healthy black spot resistant leaves that are semi-evergreen in Mississippi. It is a large rose and it needs to grow on a sturdy trellis. It's the first rose to bloom in the garden in spring and it makes a great landscape plant. Another large climbing China rose is Cecile Bruner, also known as the sweetheart rose. It is a large and robust climber. It blooms in the spring only with many soft pink blooms and lovely buds. The foliage is healthy and it's abundant. The final cultivar I want to show you today is a tea rose called Duchess de Brabant. The growth habit is spreading and graceful and there's abundant foliage. And this plant is very suitable for smaller garden spaces. The blooms are highly double, they're rose pink. They're very shapely and they're cupped in their form. This plant will bloom throughout the season and it needs a sunny, warm place to thrive. Spring has...
So you got to see some of the old garden roses we were talking about at the beginning of the show. We have another video on old garden roses and moss roses. So I'd like to go to that one too. I want to give you a look at these plants, and you can, if you want modern roses, they'll repeat bloom. But you can get some of these, even though technically, the musk roses and the rugosas, some of these are not technically old because they were developed after the first introduction of the hybrid teas. And so a lot of these have repeat blooming, so they're nice. Let's take a look at this next video clip, talking about old garden and moss roses. To give you an idea of what they look like.
Thank you.
That was a very good review of what we discussed earlier on all these old garden roses and what they look like, and a little pruning information for you too. They're pruned quite differently than you prune the hybrid teas, the floribundas, the grandifloras, which we're going to talk about now. In fact, let's continue on and talk about a few more hybrid teas. We talked about La France being the very first hybrid tea developed, and then there was just a whole bunch. Let's talk about Chrysler Imperial and bring up number 42. Of course, Chrysler Imperial is one of the most heavily scented red roses you can put in your garden. It's a hybrid tea, strongly fragrant, dark red hybrid tea. Was bred and publicly debuted by Walter Lammerts of Descanso Gardens in La Cañada, California, in 1952. Its stock parents, Charlotte Armstrong and Mirandi Dork Oxblood Red, are both All-American rose selections from 1940 and 1945. The elegantly tapered buds open into high-centered blossoms with a diameter of about 11 to 13 centimeters, is about 5 inches across, can have up to 45 to 50 petals, which is a high number for hybrid teas. Rich, deep, velvety red color, flushes in a chronological blooming pattern throughout its local season, starting in late spring until fall. The long-stemmed rose flowers are long-lasting and showy and make excellent cut flowers, as most hybrid teas do. The rose bushes reach 30 to 72 inches in height, a diameter of about 24 to 48 inches, upright form with very thorny canes and semi-glossy dark green foliage, not cold hardy in the United States, needs good sun exposure without good air circulation, susceptible to mildew and black spot, particularly in cool climates. So this would be a good rose for the interior valleys, but not so much for the coast, unless you've got good air circulation. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is number 43, Chicago Peace, a color variant of the most famous rose of all time that was discovered in the windy city of Chicago. The pink edged of Peace becomes deeper and sometimes suffuses to the entire surface of the petals. And the reverse is a deep, rich gold, a rather unstable sport, and to keep your plant pure, cut reversions to the point of origin. Same rugged plant and foliage, fragrant only if you have a good imagination, weatherproof and hardy on a tough, disease-resistant plant clothed in glossy apple green foliage. Hot weather is its favorite, and it laughs at frigid temperatures. Slight fragrance. Our next one is Pernitiana. The French breeder Joseph Pernet Ducher initiated the first class of roses to include genes from old Austrian briar roses, Rosa Foedia, with his 1900 introduction of Soleil d'Or. And let's bring that up. This is Soleil d'Or. This resulted in an entirely new color range of roses, shades of deep yellow, apricot, copper, orange, true scarlet, yellow bicolors, lavender, gray, and even brown were now possible. Originally considered a separate class, the Pernithianas, or hybrid Foedias, were officially merged into the hybrid teas in 1930. The new color range did much to increase hybrid tea popularity in the 20th century, but these colors came at a price. Rosa Foedia also passed on a tendency towards disease susceptibility, scentless blooms, and intolerance of pruning to its descendants. So this is Soleil d'Or from 1900, the first of its class. And now I don't have these pictures of some of these others. Oh, here's Soleil d'Or. Has been and still is subject to much criticism. In many climates, it sulks, suffering from serious black spot problems and being stingy with bloom. Often there is little or no late season reblooms at all. Blooms are easily damaged in wet weather and can be rather variable in coloring, depending on many variables. Still, when you get a few really beautiful blooms, they offer spectacular color and fragrance. The scent is unlike any other rose, reminding some people of grapefruit and others of oranges. To me, it smells just like orange tang. Ultimately, this is a collector's rose, since it cannot possibly compete with modern hybrid teas for continuity of bloom and sturdiness of plant. Polyanthus,
Literally, a polyanthem means many flowered roses from the Greek poly, and anthos meaning flower. Originally derived from crosses between two East Asian species, Rosa chinensis and Rosa multiflora, polyanthus first appeared in France in the late 19th century alongside hybrid teas. They featured short plants, some compact, others spreading in habit, with tiny blooms. They carried in large sprays in typical rose colors of white, pink, and red. Their main claim to fame was their prolific bloom. Let's take a look at number five, which is a polyanthus. It's Cecil Bruner. This is a climbing rose. They feature short plants, compact, spreading, tiny blooms, carried in large sprays in typical rose colors. Their main claim to fame is their prolific bloom. Spring to fall, a healthy polyanthus shrub might literally be covered in flowers, creating a strong color impact in the landscape. So this is a good landscape plant, so not so much for cut flowers. They're regarded as low maintenance, disease resistant, and remain popular for that reason. In addition to Cecil Bruner, the other varieties are the fairy, red fairy, and pink fairy. And also, this next one is Anne Harkness. It's a polyantha. This is a polyantha called Anne Harkness. Look at that color, fabulous color. And if we go back and talk a little bit more about Cecil Bruner, the sweetheart rose of your grandmother's garden, lightly scented, soft pink, miniature hybrid tea shaded, shaped, possibly the most well-known of the old roses. But Cecil Bruner is really not an old rose. Blooms burst forth on a compact, continual blooming, nearly thornless bush from spring until late fall. And Harkness, what we're looking at right here, is a floribunda rose, a variety developed by Harkness and Company, introduced in 1979. An apricot-colored rose, but with shadings of yellow at the base and in the center. Notable for flowering very late in the year, producing clusters of 6 to 20 flowers up to 7 centimeters in size. And it's from the catalog, with as many as 20 blooms per single massive truss, this rose makes a whole vase full out of one stem, exceptionally long-lasting in water. The color of its 3-inch double blooms is amber, shading to gold at the edges. A strong, narrow, upright bush with rich, deep green leaves. Good repeat bloom qualities as stood the test of time. And that's a floribunda. Actually, I thought Anne Harkness was supposed to be a polyantha. So you got me on that. Some floribundas. Let's talk about some floribundas. Floribundas, some rose beaters saw potential in crossing polyanthus with hybrid teas. And what you see here is Iceberg. This is still a very popular rose. And so they crossed a polyantha with hybrid teas. And they have hybrid tea floral beauty and color range. In 1907, the first polyantha hybrid tea roses were introduced by the Danish breeder Dines Poulsen. This had some characteristics of both parent classes and was termed a hybrid polyantha or a Poulsen rose. Further similar introduction followed from Poulsen, these often bearing the family name Elsie Poulsen. As their hybrid characteristics separated these new roses from polyanthas and hybrid teas alike, a new class was created called floribunda, Latin for mini flowering. Typical floribundas feature stiff shrubs, smaller and bushier than the average hybrid teas, but less dense and sprawling than the average polyantha. The flowers are often smaller than hybrid teas, but are carried in large sprays, giving a better floral effect in the garden. They are found in all hybrid tea colors and often with classic hybrid tea-shaped blossom, sometimes differing from hybrid teas only in their clustered flowering habitat. So they are often used in public parks and similar spaces as Anne Harkness. That's funny, they list Anne Harkness both as a floribunda and as a polyantha. There's also Dainty Maid, Iceberg, and Tuscan Sun. Let's take a look at our next picture, which is also Iceberg. So you can see the Iceberg is a really beautiful landscape rose. You get all these sprays, just absolutely spectacular. And take a look at our next one. This is also an iceberg, but it's a sport, and it's a burgundy iceberg. An iceberg, a pure white rose from German breeder Rainer Cordes. who stole the show in 1958, is one of the best known of all roses. And the rose Burgundy iceberg, which you see here in this picture, bred for hardiness and exceptional disease resistance, this Floribunda is a prolific bloomer with lovely deep wine purple blossom, compact variety that makes a perfect specimen in the smaller garden. And if we take a look, here's another Floribunda called Fire and Ice. This is our next picture. Fire and Ice, a tall, bushy Floribunda with high-scented 4-inch blooms and elegant red blend color. Repeat blooming throughout your growing season, good foliage, bloom and light fragrance too, petal count 40. Stunningly showy rose produces clusters of flower with pure white centers and flaming bright red edges, rather like the old favorite Double Delight. Fire and Ice should be widely grown for its immense disease resistance. The foliage is lush and glossy dark green and makes a wonderful foil for the magnificent procession of strong stems and blooms all over the shrub. So let's talk a little bit about now grandifloras. Grandifloras were a class of roses created in the mid-20th century to designate back crosses between hybrid teas and floribundas that fit neither category. Queen Elizabeth rose, which was introduced in 1954, and this is the Queen Elizabeth rose you see here, the grandiflora. Typically larger than either hybrid teas or floribundas and feature hybrid tea-style flowers born in small clusters of 3 to 5. Similar to floribunda, grandifloras maintained some popularity from about the 1950s to the 1980s, but today are much less popular than either hybrid teas or floribundas. So there's this is one example, Queen Elizabeth. There's also Comanche and Montezuma. And this next one is called Cherry Parfait. This is another grandiflora, number 52. So here you have Cherry Parfait. Let me just go back and talk a little bit more about Queen Elizabeth, first of his class, known for its clear pink double bloom from 1955, Portland gold medal. So ARS gold medal in 1957, Golden Rose of The Hague, 1968, beautiful pink flowers. The blooms are of moderate fragrance and usually about 4 inches in diameter. Let's talk. Now we have the Cherry Parfait, which you see here. Picture a thick helping of cherry pie filling on vanilla ice cream, and you see how this bicolor beauty earned its name. Successful in all climates, boasting beautiful large flowers and clusters on well-behaved mounding plant with dark, healthy, disease-resistant foliage. Use the nearly continuous blooms of this yummy rose to pair with perennials or shrubs or display the outstanding colors in a striking mass planting. 4-inch blooms, fragrance is light, rose is excellent in all climates, outstanding 4.5-inch cup blooms, the color of creamy white with red edging, and dark foliage make this a continually blooming rose a wonderful addition. Now let's talk about the miniature roses. Well, let's show 53, which is another Cherry Parfait, or Cherry Parfait, I should say. So it's a pretty rose, really, really pretty rose. Now the miniature roses. Dwarf mutations of some old garden roses, Gallicus and Centifolias, were known in Europe in the 17th century, although these were once flowering just as their larger forms were. Miniature forms of repeat flowering China roses were also grown and bred in China, and are depicted in 18th century Chinese art. Modern miniature roses largely derive from some miniature China roses, especially the cultivar Ruletii, a chance discovery found in a pot in Switzerland. And this one you see here is a miniature, and the name is Melandrian. Miniature roses are represented by twiggy, repeat flowering shrubs ranging from 6 inches to 36 inches in height. Blooms come in all the hybrid tea colors. Marine varieties also emulate the classic high-centered hybrid tea flower shape. Miniature roses are often marketed and sold by the floral industry as houseplants, but it is important to remember that these plants are largely descended from outdoor shrubs native to temperate regions. Thus, most miniature roses require an annual period of cold dormancy to survive, and they need full sun. So they're really not houseplants at all. And this one you're looking at is Rose Melendina is a typical miniature. Blooms are never open quite all the way and remain nice, timeless, semi-open buds until they wither. One nice thing about them is that they stay beautiful for a rather long time. And here's a miniature climbing bourbon Zeffin. Well, let's see if I can get the name. Climbing and rambling miniatures. All aforementioned classes of roses, both old and modern, have climbing forms, whereby the canes of the shrubs grow much longer and more flexible than the normal forms. In the old garden roses, this is often simply the natural growth habit. In many modern roses, however, climbing roses are results of spontaneous mutations. There is a climbing piece. There is designated as a climbing hybrid T for its genetically identical to the normal shrub form of the piece hybrid rose, except that its canes are long and flexible, i.e. climbing. Most climbing roses grow anywhere from 8 feet to 20 feet in height and exhibit repeat bloom. Rambler roses, although technically a separate class, are often lumped together with climbing roses. They also exhibit long, flexible canes and are usually distinguished from two climbers in two ways. A large overall size, 20 to 30 feet tall, is common. So is a once-blooming habit. Climbing and rambling roses are not true vines such as ivy, clematis, or wisteria because they lack the ability to cling. And they require to be supported and manually trained or tied over structures. what we have here now, Rose. Let's talk about Rosa Zeffirine Druin, climbing bourbon. Although the individual flowers are not particularly fine themselves, they are produced freely and have a wonderful fragrance. The semi-double plumes are pure shades of a bright rose pink. They're almost a thornless variety. Prefers warmer climates. Controlling disease can be a problem. Let's talk a little bit about shrub roses. And this next one is an example of what we call just a shrub rose, Rosa Molinae or Molinex. An excellent rose for bedding, although it is equally good for the border. It flowers with exceptional freedom and continuity, has an even upright growth, and little or no disease. The flowers are a rich yellow, a characteristic tea rose fragrance with musky background, winner of a gold medal, the President's Trophy for the Best New Rose of the Year, and the Henry Edlund Medal for Best Scented Rose at the Royal National Rose Society Trials. And if we move on, now the English and David Austin roses, bring up our next picture, 57. This is Abraham Darby from 1985. Not officially recognized as a separate class of roses by any established rose authority, The David Austin roses are often set aside as such by consumers and retailers alike. Development started in the 1960s by David Austin, and when he was back crossing modern roses with old roses to get roses that looked like old roses, but repeat bloomed much better than the old roses. So those are the David Austin roses, and what you hear is the Abraham Darby in the background here. And this was introduced in 1985. English rose was bred by crossing climber Aloha with flora bundle yellow cushion and is named after the industrialist Abraham Darby. Let's take a look at a couple more pictures. We're running out of time. Let's bring up 58, which is Austin Tamora. And if you could bring that up full screen just briefly and get a good look at it. And then we're going to run out of time. So this is another Austin rose. These are kind of a look of the old garden roses, but repeat bloom much better. So let's come back to me because we're really out of time. I was going to go on and talk a little bit about diseases and insects, but we've really run out of time. Roses get a lot, they get black spot, they get powdery mildew, they get rust. You need to prune that out. You can control powdery mildews with potassium bicarbonate, with some oils. But we'll talk about that next week. We've run out of time. I want to thank the crew next door for their hard work putting on the show today. And thank everyone who called in. We'll be back next week. And I think we're talking about citrus, although the schedule's been interrupted a little bit. This has been Gardens of California.
broadcast from Carson on the campus of Cal State Dominguez Hills, Cal State University of Dominguez Hills. And we'll be back next week where we'll talk more about gardens of California. Until then, I want to wish you happy gardening and enjoy our rain. We may not see it again until December if we're lucky. Take care.